Yes, hi. We want to talk a little bit about our approach of building optimization at Codecentric headquarters. This is my colleague Christina and I'm Anna. We are both IT consultants and software developers at Codecentric. Codecentric is a mid-sized IT company that is spread all over Germany, the Netherlands, Bosnia and Serbia. And about 2 years ago, Codecentric set up a new headquarter in Solingen. And this fancy new building was already equipped with all sorts of sensors and infrastructure. For example, the shutters as well as the lights already came with the sensors and you could talk with them. And what do we do when something doesn't already have internet? Of course, we hack it and connect it with the rest of the building. So our kicker table is now capable of telling you whether somebody is playing right now or not. And the pool table is even better. It automatically turns on and off the light when it notices someone is playing or not. The coffee machine is equipped with a vibration sensor, and based on the vibration pattern, it determines which kind of beverage is being made. And in general, all the meeting rooms are equipped with temperature sensors and motion sensors in order to tell you whether somebody is holding a meeting there right now or not. But why do we at Codecentric care about building optimization? Well, for starters, we're lazy, and turning on and off the light or making the shutters go up and down without leaving our desks is always a nice thing. But it's more about improving the environment we work in, not only concerning ease of use, but also concerning the energy we use. For our branch and location manager, security is important. They now don't need to come back to the office in order to check whether all the windows are closed or not. They can just sit at home, open our building optimization tools, and just close the windows if they are still open. And of course, it's fun to tinker around with all sorts of systems and sensors. And our basic architecture looks like this. We have a central system, bus systems that are connected via OpenHub, and then again we have a message broker that uses MQTT. Then we have some sort of UI in a browser that the user interacts with. We have some other sensors that are connected via RVS, and we are now going to talk about each of those components in detail.
Yeah, especially over this path, which is shown now, about the bus system, Open Hub, the message broker, and at the end about our end application for the user. So which kind of bus systems have we in our building? At first, we do have, for the heating, which is in the ceiling, BACnet running, complete infrastructure for that. We have windows where you can check if the window is open or closed. They're connected over a KNX bus. Same is for the shutters and for the lamps. They're all connected over the KNX bus. We do have some more, but that's the most important do we have. We have already said something with RVS, but that's not really a bus system, so we will come later on it too. Yeah, the most important system which we have, where our light, shutters, and lamp sensors are on, are the KNX bus. Why do we have a KNX bus? Because we have a new building. It was pretty easy to make the wires inside of our building. When you build a new building, you can put them inside. That's pretty easy. We like to have a standard. We are an office building, a huge office building. We need something which is reliable for the next 10 to 20 years. Because it's new, we need something which we also can use in 20 years. So we need something which is future-proofed and can also be used by a huge range of people and can be installed by a huge range of people. Also, the sensor support, we do need some predefined sensors, a lot of them. We have, I don't know, a lot of windows because we have only windows and we have not really walls to the outside. So we have a lot of them inside our building. Also, most parts which we are doing only in the KNX is the shutter controlling. Everything from the other parts are not done in the KNX bus, really, with Wheels Engine. The shutter controlling is only done because we need to do that as required by the guarantee of the shutters. Because when you have a specific wind speed, you must turn them off or down automatically. So that's the only reason why we're doing the shutter controlling in KNX. The main reason why we do have KNX, because our electrician knows how to work with KNX. we are software engineers. We need to work on the software. That's the way how we get money. We cannot spend all our free time inside our building to make the infrastructure. We need somebody else to do that. And that's our electrician who does this for us. Same is for the BACnet. Somebody who is making heating installation for 20 years knows what he does. We are maybe not so good in heating installations to get really power saving mode afterwards. Yeah, that's the main reason why we have Ekinix. Yeah, why do we have an open hub on top? Because Ekinix does not have a really good user interface. And the first thing was from our POs, yeah, we need something to see, something where we can push buttons and stuff like this. Yeah, and we really want to be Ekinix independent. We want to have more sensors, more things in our system. Yeah, for that, multi-bindings, I don't think I must say much about them because I think you already know all of them, or most of them, or some of them. You already used some of them. We also. And for us, the really big thing was it's open source. We love open source stuff. We love free stuff. We are software engineers. We know that a big community is better than a closed system where only 4 people are working on. We can write our own bindings if there's something missing inside. And it's free. You know, Ekinix license are pretty expensive, only once on Windows. We have really few people who can work with that, and OpenHub is pretty easy to work with. We all know, for example, Java, we can generate something inside. That's the main reason why we have OpenHub under that. We have bindings for Ekinix and BACnet, that was on the start, where we only have the UI app. But at the time, we also integrated some rules we have for BACnet. For example, when it comes over some minimum values or maximum values, that we send email notification to our heating installation, hey, there might be something wrong. Could you come please to us and check if everything is all right? And stuff like this is also implemented. At the end, we also integrated the MQTT connection. Because we have thought, we would also like to have this web service, we want to like this, we also want that our codec could extend our stuff, which we have done. So OpenHub is more like our IoT platform under the hood, and on the top, we're going to put a MQTT. Yeah, why do you put a MQTT broker on the top? As you can see, we have our UI at the end. I hope you can see it there. And the most part why we have split it is we do not want that our UI entwickler know about our open hub or all sensors under the hood. They should only get one common interface with all sensor, all systems which we have, and they can directly talk to that. They never should know if we have an open hub under the hood or if we have an RVS under the hood. They only should know, hey, this is the topic where I can control this lamp, this is the topic where I can control this shutter, the billiard dish, or something like the kicker. And we could add more apps. We have really, I think we have one. There are other guys who are implementing a second interface. Other use only topics of parts of the application. So we are going to decouple our complete system. We decouple our complete sensor system from our complete front-end system, so that we really can exchange stuff when we would like to. If we would say, this is not any mess so nice, it's all, we want to replace it, we only must replace the service at the back end, and yeah, the topic is still the same in the front and nobody must change something, it's still there. Also, when the service gets down, we could easily start a new service with the same stuff, which is only published into the same topic. Or start 5 services from the same time, they're only also publishing on the same topic. Our front-end guys never would know something about that, that there was a service down or that there was an error. We are completely decoupled. No. But there are other systems which are really get kicked out or get new in. Yeah. Exactly, we can place other backends inside of that. Now we come to our front end. Liana is going to do that.
Having a lot of things automated is nice and all, but we also want to see what is happening and maybe override some of the automatisms. And for that, we have a central UI. In our case, we call it Smart Building Board. And if you open the Smart Building Board, this is what you see, a 3D model of our office building. And from there, you can choose a floor and see some of the highlights. Some lamps are on in this image. And if you click on an area, you can see more detailed information about the area, like temperature or what meetings are happening there. And you can also control the lamps in this case. And we started implementing this in the beginning of the year during an internal IoT-themed hackathon. We implemented it in JavaScript with the 3D framework Babylon.js, which as well is open source, which is nice. And we are still working on it. More controls are coming. And when we started implementing this, what was important to us was that it's accessible to everyone easily. And so it runs in a browser. As long as you are inside of our internal network, you can just open the link in the browser and you have access to it. We also wanted it to be intuitive to use. We did not want to give our colleagues a two-day workshop just for them to be able to turn a light on or off. They should be able to figure out what to do in a minute or less. And that's one of the reasons why we specifically choose to use 3D graphics, because everybody who has been in the building a couple of times knows where they are when they see the floor plan. And we also wanted it to be clear. It means that it's not overcrowded with information and buttons and whatnot, and especially not useless information. We could have done it differently. For example, we could have used a different framework. I mean, it's JavaScript. There's tons of framework for everything. We could have also used a commercial solution and just have a guy come in, install it, and then it runs, maybe. We could have also used the OpenHub UIs. I mean, we already have OpenHub instances running in our building. So why didn't we use that? Well, like I said, it started during a hackathon. And during that hackathon, we had the common goal of implementing new sensors and integrating them all in a common dashboard. And during the last couple of months, that dashboard has evolved into the Smart Building Board as it is today. We also wanted to try out Babylon.js. We were playing around with it a little bit beforehand, but we wanted to try it out in a real setting. And Babylon.js is really easy to get into and fun to use, as well as it's offering the 3D graphics that we wanted to have for our dashboard. We also wanted to have it extendable. We are not only communicating with sensors or sensor system inside of our board, we have also integrated other services like the company calendar in order to see whether there's a meeting planned or not for a certain room. I mean, having the real life status of the room is nice, but knowing that in 5 minutes I have to leave this room is even better. And so what else do we have in our building? Like already said, we have all sorts of sensors. Like in the meeting rooms, we have motion sensors that then say, OK, this room is busy right now. You cannot enter here. The pool table was also implemented later on, as well as the coffee machine. And all of these sensors don't go via OpenHub. They go via AVS IoT. And afterwards, they are connected with other AVS services, like databases and AI. I mentioned the coffee machine that determines which kind of beverage is made. That only works with AVS Lambdas that do some sort of analysis on the data they receive and then offer a REST endpoint where we can call and get the info. Right now, it's being a latte macchiato. And other sensors then again offer an MQTT endpoint.
Yeah, we have seen which sensor systems we have inside our building, or which bus systems, to be said better. We've seen that we have OpenHub integrated, that we have a message broker, which is more like a general user interface for all front-end applications or all other servers which are going to use our systems. We have seen one of our web applications, which we are going to use to control the building. Yeah, and actually, we have a user which should use the user interface that are our colleagues in the building. We have also other systems inside of our smart building, because we have a lot of colleagues. We have a lot of colleagues who like to play around, to try new technologies, and that's what happened. You're going to have a lot of different systems in your building. What have we learned from all the things which we have implemented, which we have used? Isolation is a really good thing. You should, when you're going to make a big, for huge offices, some kind of smart home integration, you should isolate it stuff. Never should write put others in one big monolith application. It's going to kill you if there's some kind of error or if you want to extend the complete application. Yeah, fallbacks. You need to have a fallback when your network is down. An app is wonderful if you can control the lamp via the app, but if when the app is down, the network is down, you can't use it. So you should always have the hardware devices still there, and they should be working. Naming. We have a lot of sensors. To find names for the sensor is really hard, especially when colleagues should try to understand them. We have something like Northwest 1 for the shutters, and I'm always wrong with the directions. I always choose the wrong shutter to shut down. Closed system, yeah. That's actually the monolith part. If you have one big system, which is really closed, you can only use their sensors, only use their systems, and maybe sometimes they haven't what you want. So you need more besides one closed system. Yeah. It's really nice when you have a really good smart home or smart building, but not when you haven't got an intuitive user design interface. If it's not intuitive, the user can't use it and won't use it. If you're going to start your lamps via a terminal, nobody's going to use it. You need some kind of really intuitive user design to get to this point. Extendable, yeah. You do not want to have one sensor system, you want to extend your complete system with new stuff, with web servers, with a Google Calendar, so your system should be open to be extendable. Without a use case, you don't need the system. It's going to give you more complexity, more things you need to maintain, more things you need to understand, so leave it out if you don't have a use case for that. Yes, we are completely new to the topic, actually. We have started with our complete infrastructure 2 years ago when the building was built. And it was always a new challenge for us to get into this part, to understand what we now need or what we don't need. For us, it was at the start a challenge. Yeah, we are at the end of our presentation, at the end of the smart building integration. I don't think we have time for questions, but we are here at the evening, so if you have questions, come and ask us.
Thank you.